गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, अगेन वी आर बैक टू आवर कोर्स पावर जनरेशन इकोनॉमिक्स ई 704C एंड वी आर इन द मॉड्यूल वन एंड दिस इज आवर लेक्चर नंबर सिक्स एंड सो फार वी हैव डिस्कस्ड अबाउट द इन द फिफ्थ लेक्चर वी हैव डिस्कस्ड अबाउट द थर्मल पावर प्लांट्स. What are its characteristics, how a thermal power plant works, the boiler is there, the alternator is there, the and all of you know that your mechanical energy is converted into electrical energy. Now, what are the prime sources of energy? The energy sources. That is also one of the most important part that we must discuss and share. And there is some controversy regarding the nuclear, whether it will be a renewable or non-conventional or conventional regarding the uranium. So there is some controversial part is there. So broadly, we can describe our energy sources, classify our energy sources into conventional and non-conventional. Now, conventional, this is a conventional and this is non-conventional. Conventional stands for the if the quantity, availability of the quantity is finite in number. That means it is existing. It will replenish in the future, that it will not exist. So the conventional, that finite quantity, what are the finite quantities? We know that the gas, oil and coal, these are infinite in numbers. Finite, these are availability on the earth's down crust, these are in finite numbers. So when the quantity are available in finite numbers, we can tell these are conventional sources of energy, and the conventional sources of energy are gas, oil and coal. Moreover, we can say the nuclear is a conventional because uranium is non-renewable a source of energy. Now, what are the non-conventional? Non-conventional. So the non-conventional sources are wind, solar, fuel cells, tidal energy, geothermal, biogas, and the urban waste. The waste from the human beings, the urban waste, and as well as the waste from the metropolitan cities. So all the waste areas that is known as the urban waste, and biogas also. Geothermal, tidal, wind, solar and fuel cells, the batteries. So these are the non-conventional sources of energy. These non-conventional sources of energy are also called renewable sources of energy. It exists over worldwide geographical areas. You know that the wind in throughout the whole world, the wind is available. Solar, the sun rays are available throughout the whole world, and when we are in the daytime, when it is our daytime, the other part of the world, that is America, that is in fully dark. So there is a more or less 12 hours difference between America and India. Fuel cells, tidal, these are called the non-conventional. And remember, non-conventional means renewable. Here, it should not be non-renewable. Non-conventional means renewable and conventional means non-renewable. Conventional means non-renewable. Again, conventional sources of energy can be broadly classified into commercial and industry and non-commercial. And the commercial and industry energy sources are coal and petroleum. We know that the coal and petroleum are the commercial sources of energy. So we pay for the coal, we pay for the petroleum. Obviously, this is a commercial industry. commercial sources of energy. And moreover, non-commercial sources of energy are firewood, dung, and straw. Non-commercial. So the cow dung, the straw, the hay, what the cow is eating, and the firewood, the wood what from the trees. So these are the non-commercial. So what are the advantages of conventional? The conventional, we know that the thermal power plants which uses coal, these have as a high efficiency. Efficiency is high. And it, these are the well-known sources. The, till now, throughout the whole world, 60% of our energy supply is from the thermal power plants. And what the thermal power plants uses? It uses coal. So, the well-known source of energy, that is the coal, gas, during the gas turbine power plants, what we will be using. So, these are the conventional, well-known source. And the production expenses are low. And obviously, the running costs, and the capital expenditure, if we add all these things for the conventional sources of energy, the expenses are little bit low. So that's why still now the renewable sources of energy, due to the high price, we are not, it has not become, the solar has not become yet fully commercial due to the high price. So still now the coal, the generators, what they are using for the thermal generators, what they are using the coal for the production of electrical energy, and that has, that is being transported through the transmission lines, and we are at the load centers and the customer ends, we are paying less rather than if we use either solar or wind energy, the payment will be more. So the production expenses are low here. Now what are the disadvantages of conventional? Conventional is not environmental friendly. It is not eco-friendly and it can deplete soon. So the conventional sources of energy can be finished, can be over. We one day after 100 years, we may not get coal. So there will be a full crisis of the thermal power plants. So we people, for our coming generation, we are always thinking for the non-conventional, that are the renewable sources of energy, that are the solar and wind, and how to integrate with the solar and wind with the conventional. That is our main target and main achievement. We know that mostly the fuel cells and solar are working DC, and here it works in AC. So the merging of this part is a very difficult task. And uses. What are the uses of the renewable sources of energy? Till now, the renewable sources are the wind and solar, fuel cells, tidal, geothermal, biogas and urban waste. Till now, we are not very much aware of the tidal and geothermal, but some research has been developed on the wind energy, and we are getting some power of supply from the wind energy. And the solar has been used mainly for the household purposes. People are using solar power in their home, and during when they are not dearth of the power, they are supplying to the grid, and it is responsible for not polluting the environment. The solar and wind, that doesn't pollute the environment, but the coal mainly pollutes the environment. And what are the advantages? Advantages of these non-conventional or renewable sources of energy, they are inexhaustible. They do not finish. So you can get wind maybe at low speed or high speed, or when you need wind energy, that time wind is not there. When you need the wave energy from the tidal, that time it may not be there. So though it is there, but it is inexhaustible. It doesn't finish and easy to operate. So the operation is also easy. And one of the definitions of RE means renewable sources of energy definition, you can write down, it is derived from the natural process that are replenished constantly. Replenished means it can be used. It can be used one after another. It derives directly from the sun or from heat of the earth. So, the renewable sources are from the sun or from the heat of the earth. Geothermal heat from the earth and sun is solar. So, renewable sources of energy is a natural process. So, renewable, or rather you can say non-conventional, these are the natural process, but these are in finite quantities. These are in finite quantities. So, these are all about your energy sources, and you can know about the conventional and non-conventional, broadly classified. And so conventional is non-renewable and non-conventional is renewable sources of energy. So let us discuss about our hydropower plants. So you can write down, hydropower plants harness water power for generation of electric energy. Obviously, we know that the hydropower plants, they run with the use of the water. When water drops through a height, its energy is able to rotate turbines which are coupled to the alternators. So the water which is falling, that means its potential energy is high, and the potential energy is being converted into kinetic energy to run the turbines. And the energy is able to run the turbines which are coupled to the alternators. Now, what are the advantages of the hydroelectric power plants? So, in a very crucial way, we have discussed about 11 points. And what is those points? So, the hydropower plant, the life expectancy is around 50 years compared to 25 to 30 years of the thermal power plant. So, life expectancy is more in hydroelectric power plant. And number two is the, here water, though coal, you have to, for the thermal power plants, the coal you have to buy. And you know what is the energy cost, it is increasing. But for the water is the only fuel, it is cheaply available and it has no cost, approximately very low cost. So, number three, advantages. These are the advantages of hydroelectric. Number three, no standby losses. There are no losses in the hydroelectric power plants if it is run through the water, and run up can be synchronized. It can be hydroelectric power plants can be run up. It can be run up very short time, within 10 to 12 minutes, and it can be synchronized with the system. It is a very robust structure. Hydroelectric power plants needs very less maintenance. And one of the, though the efficiency of the thermal power plants is more, but here one of the advantages of hydroelectric power plants is, here the efficiency does not reduce with age. This is one of the advantages. The efficiency of the hydroelectric power plant does not reduce with age. Here, another advantage of hydroelectric, we are still supporting the thermal power plants as coal is being preserved. So the conservation of coal is there. And number eight, we can tell that there is no transportation needed for the hydroelectric power plants. For setting up a thermal power plant, coal from the other place, it must come. But for the hydroelectric power plants, it does not need any sort of transportation. And though here the total manpower in the hydroelectric power plant is very less, it can be used, the hydroelectric power plants can be used for the irrigation and the flood control. And here, hydroelectric power plants can be set up in the remote areas, can be built up in the remote areas where the land cost is very less. So we can put the dam structure, make the hydroelectric power plant in a very remote area where the land cost is very less. So these are the terminologies and advantages of the hydroelectric power plants. And regarding the hydroelectric power plants, we must remember some of the terms. So one after another, I will be telling you, and you will be writing down the terms. So here first term is run off. Run off. Now what is run off? Run off is only a small part of rainfall. Only a small part of rainfall can be used for the power generation. Small amount of rainfall can be used for power generation. Small amount of rainfall can be used for power generation. Power generation. So the rain, what it does? First of all, if rain falls, it evaporates. Then another part seeps into the soil. Seeps into the soil the another part it forms the storage, that is the underground storage. Underground storage, and some part is taken for the vegetation purpose. Some part is taken for that. And the rest part, whatever it is left, so you can write down the remaining water flows on the ground surface of the catchment area. The remaining water flows to the catchment area to form the stream. And this is known as runoff. I think you have understood, and I have made you understand. Runoff means if there is a small amount of rainfall, so that rainfall, first of all, it evaporates, seeps into the soil, this underground storage, something is used, and the remaining water flows to the catchment area to form the stream. That is known as your runoff. Now, the next part, what we will be discussing as the stream flow. Stream flow. So, you can write down that stream flow. Quantity of water flowing to the stream and its variation over the time, over a period of many years. So, you can write down the definition, quantity of water flowing in the stream. So how much water is flowing in the stream? Quantity of water flowing in the stream and its variation with time. And its variation with time over a period of many years. Over a period of many years. So I think I have made you understand that is known as your stream flow. To get that is known as your stream flow. Quantity of water, that is known as your stream flow. So it depends on, the stream flow depends on average annual energy available. So from the stream flow, what we can get, we can get average annual energy. So how much is the stream flow? So from the stream flow analysis, we can assign the what should be our average annual energy. Number two, we can assign minimum annual energy available. Minimum annual energy available and firm capacity. So how much energy minimum we can get and what is the firm capacity? Firm capacity means how much water can be pumped up to the higher head. That is known as your higher head means pumped storage plant. And that means how much water can be pumped up. So if the water is available, so how much water can be pumped up, that is known as your firm capacity. Number three, you can say it can increase the storage capacity. So from the stream flow, we can decide how much the storage also can be increased. Storage energy in a reservoir. Number four, we can daily output, minimum daily output without storage. So these are the things we can deduce from the stream flow. Now another term is hydrograph. Now what is hydrograph? Hydrograph shows the variation of stream flow. Now the variation of stream flow in meter cube per second with time over a particular river site. So this is all about your hydrograph. Now mass curve. M
मास कार, मास कार यू कैन राइट डाउन, इट इंडिकेट्स द टोटल वॉल्यूम ऑफ रन ऑफ, इट इंडिकेट्स द टोटल वॉल्यूम ऑफ रन ऑफ in cubic meters, cubic meters over a certain time. Over a certain time. So another term you can note it down, storage. So you can write down the, as the flow is deficient during a part of the year, flow may be deficient, flow may not be equal at all times, flow may be deficient during certain time. So, through artificial storage is necessary. So, artificial storage is necessary. So, some sort of storage should be prepared. Now, what is pondage? What is pondage? So you can write, the as the power demand fluctuates with time, as the power demand fluctuates with time, as we know that the load fluctuates, the power plant is away from the storage reservoir, as well as the power plant is away from the storage reservoir A small pond is needed near the power plant, is needed near the power plant is needed near the power plant to meet the hourly changes in demand, to meet the hourly changes in demand. So these are the very important definitions you have to know. And what are the next part you can ask me and discuss about the site location of the hydroelectric power plants. Now, what are the site location of the power plants, hydroelectric power plants? So, the most important points are the site location. These are the points you can elaborate yourself. Site location of hydro power. So one after another, let me tell the major points. So first of all, obviously the availability of the water. Availability of water. Second one, you can write water storage. Water storage. Number three, you can write head of the water. So head of the water increases the potential energy. And geological investigations, earthquake, and many things are there. Geological investigations. Water pollution, arsenic and other things maybe pollute the water. Sedimentation. Environmental aspects. And lastly, the access to the site. Now site is in such a place that people can't go. So these are the for a setting up a hydroelectric power plant, mostly the important is this one: availability of the water, water storage, and the head of the water. The potential of the water should be at the high level. Okay, thank you students. We will be continuing in the next class.